Again, just go and help yourself to seconds. If I could have your attention, please, we're going to start off with the pre-program program to the panel, and we're going to start. I'm going to introduce the Cherokee County Republican Party First Vice Chairman Don Ware, who's going to lead us in the invocation. And I know that everybody's already eaten, but also for the blessing of the food, either that you're about to eat or that you're already enjoying the benefits of.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for a great day, and thank you for all those that are here. Most of all, we thank you for your son and what he's done for us. We thank you for the food. Thank you for the opportunity of the veterans and the active duty folks that made it possible for us to be able to meet and enjoy it even like we're going to enjoy. Thank you for all that you've done for us and your mercy and grace. In your son's name we pray, amen.
And if you would please stand to the front on the left, you'll see our colors. And I'm going to ask Mr. David Conwick, who's one of my fellow American Legion members. This is our post. Also my fellow VFW post member. He's going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. David, where are you at?
Right here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, our Cherokee County Republican Party Chairman, Trenton Adams, I'd like to have him welcome everybody on behalf of our co-sponsor of tonight's event. Trenton?
Thank you, everybody, for coming out.
Oh, I'm sorry, sir.
I don't have too much to say other than thank you for being here. We've got our breakfast on Saturday, 9 a.m. at the Audio Intersection up in Canton. There's a coffee shop up there, Continental Breakfast, free for everybody to come in and take part in that. It'll be good to see you then. Otherwise, we've got a number of events coming up. If you check out our website, we've got a calendar on there under the events tab, and you can see everything that's happening with the Republican Party and other affiliates in the county. That's really all I have.
Our vice chair of membership, Lynn Murphy, has a couple announcements to make.
Thanks so much, everybody. If you're not already a member of the Cherokee County Republican Party, we would absolutely love for you to join tonight. We're set up. If you join tonight, you get a free shirt. And we also get to embarrass you by ringing our bell. And I am ringing it right now on behalf of Carolyn Hall Fisher, who's just joined the Cherokee County Republican Party this evening. So I'll be getting her shirt. And for first chair at our convention on June 3rd and the 4th. Thank you so much.
Second and third.
All right, tonight's event is co-sponsored between the Cherokee County Republican Party and the state organization, the Georgia Republican Assembly. Alex Johnson, the president, will be joining us later. He's at another event just south in the county. But Vice President of Georgia Republican Assembly, Brent Frost, is going to welcome everybody on behalf of our co-sponsor. He's got a couple words of another organization. Brent?
Thank you. We okay now?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Kevin. I appreciate it. Can y'all hear me all right? Can everybody hear me? Okay, good. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. Looking forward to a very good and informative evening tonight. And like you said, I'm the Vice President of the Georgia Republican Assembly, which I guess means I teach y'all how to spell potato. I show you how I invented the internet. I secretly run the whole thing with a pacemaker. I talk about people being clean and articulate, and I just sit off in the corner and look real nice while the president tears the media to shreds. So I guess that's my description as a vice president. At least that's what the last five vice presidents have done. But in all seriousness, I appreciate everybody coming out, really do. And this is a great group of folks. And you know, the one thing I would encourage you with is don't grow weary or discouraged because your numbers may seem small. In politics, it's about quality, not quantity. The people who make the difference are always a minority. The world has never changed by massive lumbering majorities. It's small, dedicated minorities who will never tire, never stop fighting, never stop pushing. So I appreciate everyone. And real quick, as Kevin mentioned, I'm also the executive director of the Georgia Republican Assembly PAC, which is basically our political arm at the GRA, where we, after we endorse candidates, we give them financial support. And I'll tell you, right now, we are looking for a few good men and women to turn the state around. It only takes a couple hundred, believe it or not, at a very small level of financial support to make a big difference and send 5, 10, 15 new state legislators in the next session to the Gold Dome, and then 5, 10 more, 15 in the next session, and pretty soon we've got the whole thing under new leadership. And here's the best part of it. You're gonna hear from gubernatorial candidates all throughout this next year, and they're gonna tell you, vote for me, vote for me, vote for me. They're gonna need to raise between $2 and $5 million to win the nomination. And that's just to win the nomination. Then they have to go up against Stacey Abrams in the fall. You know how much it would take to get ourselves an entirely new leadership in the House of Representatives, which means new legislation, new committee chairs, killing bad legislation and promoting good? Somewhere between $250,000 and $750,000. So you give me one third of the state government for $5 million, the governor, or one third of the state government for $500,000. I'm no financial expert, but it seems to me which one is the better option. So if I'm not able to be here for the whole night, Alex will be here. You can talk to him. You can talk to Kevin. GRA PAC. We're on Facebook. Our website is georgiara.com. I'd encourage you to look us up. If you're tired of being lied to time and time and again by career politicians, if you want to do something about it, this is your way to do it. I call it rhino insurance. They've taken over $300 out of you, each of you, this year and last year in new gas taxes. The way I look at it, I'll put that into getting a rhino defeated rather than putting it into the tax man's coffers when he comes calling every April 15th. So thank you very much, everyone. I hope you all enjoy the evening. And that's some pretty good barbecue. If you hadn't had some, you better go eat it.
one of the potential beneficiaries of the GRA PAC, and the paltry amount of money that I get to pay each month to put into that, we got Mr. Ken Pullen, if you please stand up. He's a candidate for Georgia House of Representatives District 131, so he's traveled just a little ways to be with us tonight. Welcome, Ken. Michael Stroyo, he's a candidate for Georgia GOP First Vice Chair. He's with us tonight. Michael?
Thank you.
Are there any other candidates out there for either elected office or for party office that I did not recognize? Oh, good. Other than the persons that are on the panel, which you're going to hear plenty of from tonight, are there any elected officials here tonight that I need to recognize? All right, fabulous. I'm going to ask the panel members to take your seats on the panel. While our panel members take their seats, all six of them are going to be here. Senator Brendan Beach, he called about an hour and a half ago to say he has been double tasked by his staff. He's working some cybersecurity issues. He'll be traveling from that to join us. So he may gain us in stride, but he'll be here before very long. Just a couple very, very simple ground rules. This is a panel discussion. Like I told one of the panel members yesterday, our intent is for this to be more C-SPAN and PBS-like than to be CNN or Fox or MSNBC-like. And I think that the topics that we're talking about kind of demand that. The topics are pretty broad, and we could probably stay here every night for the next several weeks to talk about these particular topics. So our challenge is one to hit on the most salient ones, right? And also to set a few ground rules about how much that we talk. And for that purpose, I sent out to all the panelists yesterday morning all the questions that they will be asked tonight. Because this isn't supposed to be a surprise question thing. We actually want them to have thought through them. And many of them have dealt with this. Some of them have spoken on and dealt with these particular topics in one form or another. We've got an extraordinarily diverse panel. I think that's a great thing for all those that talk about unity in a big tent within the Republican Party. I think that this particular panel is something to cheer about. And quite honestly, I think this kind of discussion is that we could use more of in our party. The ground rules timekeeper, Jim Murray, the president of Cherokee County Republican Assembly. He's our timekeeper, and he has our rules are here in a minute. I'm going to give a very brief introduction, starting from my right to my left, and the opposite for you all, on the brief introduction, and then we will give each of the panel members 2 minutes to introduce themselves, to provide a kind of an overarching philosophy of what they think is most important. I told them, make it their preamble to the discussion that will follow over the next couple hours on the topics that we have. All right, so that will be 2 minutes in length. So when you get down to about 30 seconds in your 2 minutes, Jim will have a visual indicator. Jim, how about showing us the visual indicator?
The high tech.
There you go.
Yeah. Is that Atlanta Gaslight?
Yeah, that's how I marked my summit I put in last week. See, it always serves a second purpose. And then at the end of that time, we're not going to be rude, as in some forms. So these are not candidates we're competing with each other for office yet. Okay, so at this point, what we want to do is, when it reaches time, he'll just give you the visual indicator, and unless you start, looks like you're not going to come to a close before he says stop, or before I take the mallet and get your attention in that way. And then the step after that, well, we don't want to discover that. Okay, and then after that, we have a set of six questions. I've got two in reserve. In the event that at the end of that, we haven't worn out either the panelists, or if you've still got the energy to do that, we can go into those two questions reserved. But I've got the six that I provided to them. I also provided one of them in reserve, and I came up with one additional one beyond that. Each of the panelists will have 3 minutes for each of those. It's one of the challenges that you have when you have six members on a panel. A lot of ground to cover, a lot of critical, important topics that we need to talk about. And I think that the timing for this is pretty critical. For one, if you think, one, we've had more than a month now to reflect on the assembly that just, and the last assembly session that just ended in Atlanta, where several days past that mythical and somewhat made up and not really necessarily meaningful 100 days in President Trump's administration, and we're 2 days past a resounding victory for the Georgia Senate race to replace Judson Hill by Dr. Kate Kirkpatrick. And that bodes well. If it had not been such a resounding victory, I'd be more concerned than I am on the election to be held on June 20th with Karen Handel. But right now, I'm feeling pretty good about that. Okay, a quick introduction. On my right, your left, we have Representative Matt Gurtler. He's a businessman, a contractor. He's a Georgia representing the 8th District up Dahlonega way. He himself is from Tiger, Georgia. And he has just finished his first assembly session, so he's serving his first term. And then we have Jack Staver, who's also a businessman. He's a member of the Cherokee County Republican Party. He's a citizen lobbyist. He's well known by all the other panelists that you see up here. He is also on the State Board of Georgia Republican Assembly, as well as the National Federation of Republican Assemblies. And he's also a member of the Cherokee County Republican Assembly. And then we have Senator Josh McKoon, back from my old neck of the woods, where I lived for 10 years before I moved up north here, from Columbus, Georgia. He's a lawyer. He's a Georgia Senator, District 29, since the year 2010. He's from Columbus, Georgia. He has declared that he will not be seeking re-election for that office. So that's one of the reasons why he was one of the very first persons, other than the fact that he's traveled the state, and I'm very familiar with him and the views, because I think he's got things to say on this topic. But, and also, there's a certain beauty in when you're not seeking re-election that you can be candid in the way that you otherwise would not be. And that's a good thing. All right, not with us at this time, but he will be joining us, is our own regional representative, and that would be Georgia Senator Brandon Beach. He's CEO and president of the North Fulton Chamber of Commerce, Georgia Senator, District 21, lives in Alpharetta, Georgia, and he has served in that as a Georgia Senator since 2012. And a member of the last panel that we did a couple months ago, and she did so well, and she was quoted so much by Saadi, who here just joined us, that's great, because she's very articulate. She's a lawyer. She's president of the Dekalb Young Republicans, and she's a former candidate for the 80th House District, Catherine Bernard. And on the one member of this panel who is not a Republican, which I think is a good thing too, right? Because we're big enough that we can hear other ideas. Perhaps more conservative than about 80% of the Republicans that I know anyway. Mr. Ricardo Davis, he is chairman of the Georgia Constitutional Party, so he's probably got something to say about ballot access tonight. And he's also president of the Georgia Right to Life, which I think is one thing that all people in this room and he can probably agree on, and a number of other things, I'm sure. Okay, having said that, we'll start the 2 minutes, and we're going to start in the order that I introduced them. Matt, take 2 minutes to just for your preamble and whatever else I missed on you.
Well, thanks, Kevin. Thanks for having me. I'm Matt Gurtler. I represent the 8th District, which is Towns, Union, Raven, and a little bit of White County. I was just recently elected in just last year, and my first session, just got done with it during 2 months ago maybe. On the flyer it said I was a constitutional conservative. I'll take that. I definitely am a conservative and a constitutionalist, but I've been trying to put that out. The term a limited government conservative Republican. I know that's really a big mouthful, but you know, nowadays when you say you're a Republican, it really doesn't mean much anymore. My basic philosophy is that government is here to protect life, liberty, and property. That's about it. You see it now, it's intruding in pretty much every aspect of our lives unnecessarily. Overall, when I look at the bill, I see what is this? Is it going to intrude unnecessarily, increase the size and scope of government? And is it constitutional? And that's how I voted this session. There's not many of us down at the Capitol, I'll tell you what. But I'm glad that we have a lot of people here tonight that are interested in trying to make things change. Going forward, we'll have a part-time legislator, and we'll talk about that tonight, 40-day sessions. So it's kind of like a full-time, part-time job in a way. But I look forward to answering the questions. We have a great group here. I'm glad everybody turned out too. Thank you.
Jack Staver.
Good evening. First of all, I want to thank my amazing wife for supporting me and helping me through this whole thing. She's sitting right back there. I grew up what I believe to be a Republican household. My parents always voted. My first presidential election for me was in 1972 when Richard Nixon won by a landslide. I always did my civic duty and voted because it was the right thing to do, and I felt I could make a difference. So let's fast forward now to really April of 2009. We attended the Tea Party meeting in Atlanta, and that was the catalyst for everything. Shall we say an epiphany? Since then, the blinders have been removed, and I have been able to observe and learn the system and how broken it really is. Let me throw a quick disclaimer out here. Not all elected representatives fit this mold, but the number is few and far between. There are some R's down there, but not many, at least by their actions, such as denying transparency, which Josh McKoon knows because we fought that together in the Senate, the referendum on the JQC, which is another one of Josh's, and Catherine was involved in that also, on last November ballot, having the Foch watch the hen house, basically, tax increases such as the internet tax, fantasy football, giving Delta tax breaks. This just irks me so bad I can't stand it. When they made a paltry $4.2 billion profit last year. A lot of ran on Republican tickets, like my opponent did when I ran for the commission race. 39 years, the guy lived in New Jersey, was never registered as a Republican. But he ran on a Republican ticket, he would say. So there's a lot of these out there. Their voting record tells the tale. Will the real R's please come out from behind the curtain? The founders gave us a representative republic, yet the Georgia legislative body operates like an oligarchy. And the few, the oligarchs, seem to be promoted, moved up on the ladder to college presidents, GDOT planning director, and by the way, the very same Jay Roberts, while the T-Splost was going on, stated that we know parts of this are done unconstitutional, but we're going to do it anyway. That's on film. Ooh, you have to deduct the time for my wife. Everything that's done at the Dome should be based on Constitution and the rule of law. Okay, so I'll jump forward, just for you, Jim, I'll jump forward a little bit. Okay, this oligarchy has a stranglehold on the Gold Dome and is stifled the way it should be, and the constituents suffer while so-called representatives march to the tune of the lobbyists and puppet masters. Your vote, in a way, instructed you vote, or you're minimized and put in the corner. Is it fame or fortune or just plain lack of backbone to stand up to the oligarchs and just say no? The committee chair says this is the governor's bill, we have to pass it. Two great examples being T-Splost, the opportunity school districts, both soundly defeated when we the people stood up and said enough is enough. These were real grassroots efforts by the people, for the people, great victories for Georgians. When people reject liberty, big government socialist solutions, the state turns around and punishes the people by ramrodding the largest tax increase in Georgia history that has not solved one problem yet. But let's not forget the budget. You have to vote for the budget. This is the rally cry and all but a few against it. Okay, I want to close with this one thing. I want to leave this with you. When truth is the enemy, tyranny has taken over. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I want to congratulate Kevin on putting together this very distinguished panel and me. It's wonderful to be here in an American Legion Hall. It's good to, I think, always remember the sacrifice of our armed forces, and it's really special to spend some time in this room, and I got here a little early and had an opportunity to look around and just see the history of this place. Just very briefly, my grandparents, my grandfather, left school in the eighth grade to help take care of his family, worked in the Eagle and Phoenix Mill, worked on the railroad, went off to World War II, came home, married my grandmother, and they had a grocery store at 5th Avenue and 8th Street in downtown Columbus. My dad was the first member of our family that went to college. He and my mom, who was a career victim service officer with the district attorney's office in Russell County, Alabama, raised me to understand that to whom much is given, much is required. And that's really what animated my interest in politics and government. Led me to run for the state senate in 2010, and I've been fortunate to be reelected three times. I would say, you know, we have a crisis on our hands at the national level, the state level, and the local level, and that is largely due to the fact that our founders did not give us a government where the people are supposed to be spectators. People are supposed to be active participants in their government, and it requires a lot of effort on the part of average citizens, which is why I am so grateful. I would drive anywhere to be with a group like this who are actively engaged in trying to make their government better and make their government responsive to the will of the people. But that's what I've been about during my time in the General Assembly, is trying to level the playing field, whether that was with ethics reform, to reduce the influence of lobbyists who are giving over $2 million in gifts on an annual basis to the members of the Georgia General Assembly, or more recently, where I've been engaged in a fight to simply require that your right of free exercise receives the same respect and that the government is restrained from interfering with that right in the same way the government is restrained from interfering with your right of free speech, free association, or freedom of the press. I believe in limited constitutional government, and I look forward to the discussion we're going to have this evening. Thank you very much.
Catherine.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming out. I just want to echo everything the other panelists have already said about the importance of an informed electorate that is holding our government accountable. My name is Catherine Bernard. I live in Brookhaven now, which is Georgia's second newest city. I'm from Virginia originally, and I'm one of those people who always knew I was going to be a lawyer. So I've spent most of my life studying law from the perspective not of being someone who would participate in it, but from the perspective of someone who saw themselves as controlling the law. And that's what they really teach you in law school, is that even if you don't know anything about anybody else's life, you can still make rules and regulations about it that should bind them to it. And I thought that was okay for a long time. Then I became a public defender in rural Georgia, and it was like the scales fell from my eyes. I realized that Ronald Reagan was right when he said the scariest words in the English language are, "I'm from the government and I'm here to help." I saw every day, and I continue to see, how well-intentioned government programs are actually making life worse for millions of Georgians. So I converted to Republicanism. I became a Republican. I actually was honored enough to be elected a delegate to the 2012 National Convention, and I didn't cast my vote for Mitt Romney. That didn't make me the most popular person with the governor and certain other elected officials, but it did bring me into contact with a lot of other people who felt the same way, but maybe just hadn't had the opportunity to express it. And so as I've traveled around Georgia for politics and for law, I've met people all across the state who are really serious about restoring constitutional government. And it's just been so incredibly inspiring. And that's why I'm so excited to talk about these great questions, really challenging questions that Kevin has put together for us tonight, because if we don't grapple with them, our legislators are not going to. We have to be the engine putting pressure on them in order to make popular sovereignty work. And I might have to move this mic a little closer. I did have to bring my copy of the Georgia Constitution with me today. Sadly, it is not one of those handy little pocket constitutions like our federal one. It is 80 solid pages of wonderful excitement there. And so I'm excited to talk about these issues from the perspective of someone who has understood the importance of limited government, having been smacked in the face with it. Oppressive government truly is the greatest evil that we can see.
Ricardo.
Good evening, everyone. It is truly a blessing to be participants with friends who are fighting for the restoration of the Republic. And again, thank you, Kevin, for the opportunity for me to come and participate in the panel today. As he noted, I'm head of two organizations, Georgia Right to Life and the Constitution Party of Georgia. So I was going to introduce myself primarily through just kind of laying a foundation of where those organizations are coming from. The Constitution Party's state platform states in part, quote, "We acknowledge and fear the God of the Bible as creator, supreme judge, lawgiver, and king. We solemnly declare that the foundation of our political position and the motivating principle of our political activity is our full submission and unshakable faith in our Savior and Redeemer, the Lord Jesus Christ. Consequently, the principles and the platform of our party are rightly derived from biblical presuppositions. We acknowledge the legacy of our founding fathers who believed that, quote, a frequent reoccurrence to fundamental principles, unquote, is essential to securing liberty and good government. We further acknowledge our heritage as a Christian nation, as confirmed by the U.S. Supreme Court when it ruled in 1892, quote, that our laws and our institutions must be based upon and embody the teachings of the Redeemer of mankind," unquote. "It is confirmed by human experience and evidenced by history that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. We hereby look to him for wisdom, guidance, boldness, compassion, humility, and endurance as we seek to restore and preserve our communities and our nation. We acknowledge the fallen condition of the human race and look to Jesus as our only hope for personal and cultural salvation. The Constitution Party of Georgia holds candidates accountable to this platform and in their policies and in the execution of their duties. And it ends by quoting George Washington, where he says, if to please the people we offer what we ourselves disapprove, how can we afterward defend our work? Let us raise a standard to which the wise and honest can repair. The event is in the hands of God. Likewise, Georgia Right to Life's Articles of Incorporation begin with, in particular, this one sentence. The corporation is organized as a Christ-centered, biblical-informed organization dedicated to the nonviolent advancement of the recognition and protection of the God-given, unalienable right to life of all innocent human beings as legal persons. And that, my friends, is when I got the questions, I'm looking through that in those lens, or with that lens.
For the first question, I'm going to take it in the same order that we did the introductions, and then I promise you we'll reverse it.
You'll mix it up a little bit.
So it's not the same person always going. All right, the first question. A reason often given for the Georgia legislature being set up with relatively low pay and an abbreviated session is so that they must have a day job and live like the rest of us, feeling the impact of the laws that they pass. Do you, panelists, think that the legislatures feel the impact of the laws that they pass? Is there a conflict of interest between some legislators' day jobs and the bills that they act on? Do you advocate for modifying the current pay and session length, and why? We start with you, Representative Gurtler.
Thank you. I've got this question, I started to think about it, and a lot of people say that the most dangerous times in Georgia is when we're in session. So I don't know if every state's different. We have 40-day sessions here in Georgia. Some states have 20 days. Some states, well, Georgia used to meet once every 2 years. It is a part-time job. Like I said before, it's kind of a full-time part-time job. A lot of my colleagues, though, are independently wealthy or retired. I'm a contractor, and I do feel the effects, I think, a lot more than a lot of people. The rules, regulations, the extra taxes, simply because you have to live in the real world every single day. One thing that made me think about it is, even if we had, 6 months of legislating, you have to respect the process. Jack kind of touched on that. Playing politics with people's rights isn't right. And my time as a legislator, I was an aide for 4 years, and then I was elected. And it was very upsetting to see the inside workings, how the sausage is made, I guess. this first session. And I don't know if the unintended or the intended consequences of having a longer legislature or a shorter legislature really make a difference if people don't respect the process in the first place. But that's kind of my take on it, modifications and things like that. We have to elect people that are actually going to be principled. That's my big thing. You've got to elect people that are going to stand by the principles no matter what, no matter if it's the speaker's bill or the lieutenant governor's bill or whatnot. And having more people like that in the legislature ultimately will make the difference. And I think that this year we should be able to elect some more principled legislators, and we can make a difference that way.
Thank you, Jack.
All right. Hold on a second. There's a blue Honda CRV parked inside the gate outside, and they're going to lock the doors, or they're going to lock the gate outside. So if you have a Honda CRV and you parked it inside the gate, you need to move it because they're going to lock it in.
There's two gates. You need which? The gate by the ball fields?
I guess.
Okay.
Is that correct?
The gate going to the Legion building, there's a Honda parked inside there, and they're going to lock it.
We have a victim, I think. Okay, this is you know, the 40-day session is probably really okay if, number one, and this is in my opinion, because they typically start the sessions at 10 a.m. and by noon, they're done. So then they all say, well, we're in meetings all day. No, they're not. That just doesn't work that way. I've been going down there for, what, 6-7 years now? It doesn't work that way. And there's a lot of people down there that are really just playing around. There's a few people that are down there for a very serious purpose, and they are actually representing us is what they're supposed to be doing. It's for we the people. It's a servant job. It's not a part-time, playtime job with a lot of these guys that it is. The biggest thing is that they wait till the very end, then we get the signy die, and guess what? They ram everything down our throats when nobody sees it. Yeah. Transparency isn't there. Like I say, with that SR-24 that Josh had, would have helped to prevent some things that happened prior to signy die happening, but that didn't happen because nobody would even entertain the thing. It was a travesty what happened in the hearing that we had. It was terrible. And the more people we need to get down there to come down there to support this, to support these guys, the further along they're going to be. And there are certain people who really are putting it out there and really need to do it. But how many of them do you see at Republican meetings? It's a Republican party. Do you see them on Republican meetings? Do you see them be involved? Very, very minimal amount of people need to do that. And it's up to us to encourage these guys to do it. Otherwise, it's time for us to step up and go down there and do this. And I keep hearing, well, I can't do that. Why can't we do it? I ran for commissioner. I tried. And here's the whole thing. If we don't try, nothing's going to happen. If our founder said, well, this is really hard because the bears keep coming, I'm just going to stay home today, where will we be right now? So it's up to us. It's our duty, our sacred honor to keep the legacy going and to fight this.
If they didn't, we'd be saying, God save the Queen.
Yes.
So this is a great question. I would say, number one, on the sort of the pay side, I'd echo what Representative Gurtler said. Now, this is sort of a unique situation. Senator Beach, myself, Representative Gurtler, we all work full-time. We have real jobs in the real world. But the majority of the state legislature, you're dealing with people who are retired or independently wealthy. There's nothing wrong with that, but is it reflective of the 10 million people that we are supposed to be representing? I would submit to you that it is not. It would be much easier if we had there's several states that have this. I introduced legislation this year calling for it, a compensation commission to look at what individual legislators should make so that they've got enough resources so that someone can afford to be away from their job for 3 months. Because it is difficult. If you're in business for yourself, as I am, you have 12 months of overhead and 9 months of income. That's a difficult situation to work out. So I do think that's something that we should look at. The other side on the session, the biggest thing I would tell you is that we need to split the session. session needs to be split between the first part, which needs to be the adoption of the budget. That is the only thing we are constitutionally obligated to do. Why should we adopt the budget and have the governor sign the budget before we act on anything else? Because the budget is routinely used to bully members, to punish members, to buy votes. It is horribly unethical. It is a terrible way to run your government. But it happens. It happens every session. And I don't care who the governor is. This isn't a personal criticism of anyone. But if you give them that authority to say, well, the budget's going to be in play the same time all these other issues are in play, you better believe budget items are going to get tied to members' votes on these other issues. There's a reason that we set aside a summer session once every 10 years to deal with redistricting, and we don't do redistricting during the regular legislative session, because we don't want members leveraged over unrelated issues to get them to vote a certain way on other public policy issues before the General Assembly. So if there's one thing we could do to transform the way the legislature operates, it would be to figure out a pay structure that allows people to serve from all walks of life, and to split the session so that the budget could no longer be used as a hammer to hit people with to get their compliance with legislation they would never vote for in other circumstances. So those are the two things that I think are most important in that regard.
I want to welcome our sixth panelist, Senator Beach. For his benefit, I'd like to know that we explained that you were working some cybersecurity issues.
Well, no, it was a venture capital at Georgia Tech at the ATDC. We were looking at how we can get venture capital to private venture capital, not government money, but private capital to come to Georgia. We birth a lot of these ideas out of Georgia Tech, and we have some great ideas that come out of Tech. But they have to go to Silicon Valley or Boston to get their financing, and when they do, those jobs leave. We've educated these kids, we've come up with these brilliant ideas, and then they leave our state and go create jobs in California or Boston. So we want to, that's what we were working on. And so I apologize for being late. I kind of got overbooked, but and with traffic, I'm sorry I'm a few minutes late. But I think the question is about part-time legislature. Is that what the question is about?
That's right, Senator.
Yeah, I would tell you, I'm all for a part-time legislature. I love my job as a legislator, but I love my real job that, you know, supports my family. And I think it's good that we have a job, that we know what's going on. I'm very fortunate. I have 22 employees that allow me to go down there January, February, March to be a senator. But, you know, with technology now, I can stay in touch with my office pretty regularly and stay on top of everything. I don't think we should ever go through to a full-time legislature. Albeit, I will tell you today, I played senator all day. This morning, I got up, I went to a GDOT board member, then the governor came and spoke to GDOT on I-85, and what a great job they did getting that built in 6 weeks. And then we had U.S. Secretary of Transportation, Elaine Chao, come and we did a ribbon cutting. And then I went to Georgia Tech and did some things, and then went to that panel then, and now I'm at another panel, and I'll get home at 10 o'clock tonight. That being said, I love being part of the process and being part of the legislature. I do want to just say, while I do have the microphone on I-85, GDOT deserves a heck of a lot of credit for them to get that. For those in the transportation world, or that are not in the transportation world, to get that road built in 6 weeks is nothing short of lightning speed, and it's very, very good. And it took a concerted effort on everybody's part. So I'm really proud, and I got to tell you, it just shows. I gave a speech the other day and talked about that road being built in 6 weeks, and I had a lady raise her hand, and she said, well, how can that be safe? What's happened is we've conditioned the public to think it takes 5 years to build a road. What takes so long to build a road is all the bureaucracy before you build the road, the NEPA studies, the permitting, the Corps of Engineers studies. Once we put a shovel in the dirt, we can get the road built pretty quickly. So that just is a example of how we got that done in 6 weeks. So, and it is safe. It's probably the safest bridge in the state of Georgia. It's been inspected. So anyway, that's where I was today doing that. So I was a full-time legislator today, but I like being a part-time legislator and having another job. Can I ask one question? How do y'all feel with a raise of hands of us giving C.W. Matthews a $3 million bonus to get that road built in less than 6 weeks?
No.
You're against it or for it?
Against it. It's all work anyway.
Well, that was President Trump called us that night that it happened. It happened on day 40, and we waived everything because we had to get that bridge reopened. I mean, every day that was closed, it was causing economic damages.
Pain causes people to change what they're doing. We need to create more pain so people actually respond differently. The notion that you're saying it takes so long to build roads, what's really going on is we're building roads over and over, repaving stuff, so somebody gets paid money when they probably should be getting paid more than they actually should get paid. Those are parts of the issue. We're conditioned as the people just go along with it all. Free market's gone.
Yeah. Okay.
Why are we?
I don't want to turn this into we got five more questions to do. This is not going to be a Senator Beach Town Hall.
That's okay. We'll talk transportation.
Catherine.
Why are we here then?
Are there no comments allowed?
You want to say questions and answers or anything?
No. It will not be. Specifically, as was put out up front, is we want to take advantage of this diverse panel that we have. Trust me, let's let the discussion here. They'll make themselves available, and you can make your voice known to them after this meeting, before this meeting, or anytime. Or you could spend time down at the State House, guys like citizen lobbyists do, and make your voice heard more often. There's a lot of different ways to do that. But that is not the primary function tonight. We've got six diverse folks to do that.
He asked the question. I answered.
Yes, he did. All right. No. Catherine, you on the floor.
On the issue of the part-time legislature, I certainly hope there's nobody out there suggesting we need to make the Georgia legislative session longer. That kind of scared me when I heard Representative Gurtler over there talking about making it 6 months. I think 40 days, you know, we're already seeing literally thousands of pieces of legislation being pushed through, and there's acknowledgments from many of the members that they're simply not able to read all of the legislation. So we certainly don't need to extend the process when we're already seeing how much bad stuff is going on right now and how it's unmanageable. As for the issue of part-time legislators, I'll have to say, I don't really feel like in practice we have a part-time legislative system. And I say this as a lawyer who has run for office against other lawyers mostly, and I look at the folks we have on this panel, we have a lawyer, a contractor who has previously worked in politics, and someone who leads a Chamber of Commerce, which is a very highly politicized organization. So while these three men all have wonderful things to offer to the legislature, their real day jobs have a lot to do with politics. And I'm seeing more and more of this bleed over. And again, I'm saying this as a lawyer. You know, we had at the Federalist Society, the person that I ran against, who is now my state rep, said that, you know, her bosses gave her 3 months off for the campaign. And I thought, wow, that's a pretty good deal. But, you know, it really is limiting the pool of people who can reasonably think about becoming a representative. I hear we need more lawyers up there. I think we need fewer lawyers up there. You know, if any. I say this with all the respect for the good lawyers who are out there fighting it out. But, you know, our law has become just far too complex, and lawyers have gotten very comfortable with that. We need more people to get up to the State House who are not within the political circle, not within the political bubble, and who really have that fresh perspective that I think our founders really counted on for designing our constitutional republic.
Ricardo. Why, thank you. So now, you asked a lot of questions there, Kevin. But what are the ethical concerns behind the question? And the one that just jumped out to me is an old-fashioned word, peculations. Who knows what peculations are? Okay, here's a definition. The abuse of the elected official's authority to appropriate public money in such a way as to benefit them in retaining are gaining additional political power, or abuse of said authority to embezzle monies from the public treasury
for public gain. For me, that is the core, I mean, the real heart of why we see the problem in our current system. The current system, however, is preferred and beneficial in that it incentivizes individuals to be, one, productive, and two, successful in managing their affairs such that they could donate their labors in the management of the people's business. Such a system requires the appropriate understanding by the candidate or the elected official regarding their responsibility. So that's number one. They have to understand what they are sent there to do. And it assumes the moral character necessary in order to fulfill those responsibilities. You rarely have the first, and the second's a tall order. Okay? This is basically what we're dealing with here. Let me see if I can wrap this up. The predominant worldview that permeates our culture and really is evident down there at the State House, in the early days of our government, high moral character was assumed. And it was demanded by the electorate. And even though it wasn't perfect, because we're all human beings, there was a transcendent source of truth in ethics. And quite frankly, our current Constitution, which Catherine has in her hands there, recognizes this in the preamble. But in the culture we live in today, where philosophical relativism is the moral foundation and the ethics of utilitarianism is the standard of governance, these things have led us to where we are today. So in one sense, I don't necessarily see that, the need for someone to be able to give of their time for 3 months plus is necessarily a hindrance. I think it should speak well of the folks that we elect there, that they have so governed themselves that they can give up their time to do this. However, we the people do need to be wary and to keep an eye on their connections. And this is the point that Catherine made, is that we need to see, hold on, are they able to do this because they are benefiting from peculation? Okay, we're going to change the order. We're going to start with Jack here. So, Matt, you're not always going to be first, and then we'll work it down that way. In fact, I'm going to skip the second question because you already touched on that one. I'm going to go to the third. I may come back to the second one. Right. Number three, the last Georgia legislative session has been deemed by some as the least Republican session in memory. Others have called it unproductive or do nothing. Can you comment on these opinions and share your own? Jack Staver.
Well, I spoke a little bit about it when we started and talked about fantasy football tax. Jay, the tax man come with Powell, is the guy, if you look at any bill that's associated with taxes, that's where he's driving all these things. And as a limited government, which we should be, and as a Republican, and there's also another legislator that I want to tell you about. Somebody had lunch with Bill Couser. Bill Couser is one of the Senate leaders, and he said the Republican Party is insignificant. So if this is the opinion of what we have down here, what can we expect from the session? What can we expect from these guys? Can we expect them to have lower taxes? Can we expect them to not put all these bills through? Fantasy football, this was just another way to get them to get more money into the coffers of the state. It didn't care about us, internet tax. So Delta can get a tax credit when they fly to Phoenix, they don't have to pay for tax, but if I go to Phoenix and buy something online, I have to pay tax for it. Where we're apples and oranges here. So if our legislators, and again, I said this when I started, not all of them do this, but most of them do, they're more concerned about what happens with the state and making the state bigger, making it run, than we, the people. And it's supposed to be about us. They're supposed to represent us. But that hasn't been happening. This last session, there's so many things. I mean, I could sit here for an hour and tell you all the bad stuff we did. You know, I know we just gave a credit for people with, for boats, $35,000 tax credit for people who have boats, that they don't have to pay tax over that. Look this stuff up. I don't make it up. And this is the kind of stuff that, who suffers for? Who pays for this? Anybody in here know who pays for this? Raise your hand. We do. So until some of these things start, until they start listening to us and actually being representative of us, not being representative of the government, things aren't going to change, folks.
So this was my seventh legislative session. I don't know that I would say it was any more or less Republican than the preceding six sessions. They all kind of seem the same to me. I do want to say a word about the daily fantasy sports issue, because you know, Senator Beach has a proposal on casino gaming, and he and I may not agree on that, but he has gone about that the right way. He has done it in an open an honest manner and made it clear what his public policy goal is. The daily fantasy sports crowd wanted the legislature to pass a bill that said gambling on daily fantasy sports was not gambling because it was a game of skill. Now, I don't know how betting on ball games is a game of skill any more than betting on racehorses would be. But that's the kind of stuff that was eating up most of the resources, the limited resources of our 40-day session. When I think about what do Republicans want, or what does the Republican Party stand for, I would like to think that it stands for working people. It stands for the people that get up in the morning to go to a job or run their own business and to employ themselves and maybe some other people too. And to take care of their families. They're not waking up in the morning waiting for a check to arrive from the government. And so if that's who we are, if that's who we want to be, then we ought to be for tax reform that benefits everyone. We should be for tax reform that puts us all on the same page. We should be for broadening our tax base and bringing down marginal rates, right? I mean, isn't that what we're for? Isn't that what we're about? But in 7 years, it seems that we are simply incapable, a Republican supermajority legislature, of giving you that relief. Now, Senator Beach and I voted for a bill that would bring down the state income tax rate, but we couldn't get that past the goal line. We couldn't get it to the governor's desk. But there were all manner of tax breaks. I think somebody scored it and they said over a five-year period, all the tax breaks that were passed, I don't know how many were signed into law, but if all the tax breaks that were passed were signed into law, it would have been a $483 million charge to Georgia taxpayers over a five-year period. And I could sit here and make the case for every single one of them. You know, if I give your business a special tax break, you're going to be able to tell me how you're going to create jobs and invest in capital equipment. I'm sure you can, but that's not the point. The point is, we ought to have broad-based tax policy. Either everybody counts or nobody counts. And I could go down the list. I know I've only got 2 minutes, but you know, we could talk about educational choice. We could talk about having open, transparent, honest government that we promised when the Democrats were in charge. We won't run things like the Democrats. And yet we're voting on bills at 12:45 a.m. on day 40 of the legislative session. So no. It was not, in my view, a Republican legislative session. But then again, I haven't found the preceding six sessions to be very reflective of what I hear from my constituents in my district. I think that we can do better. I think that the people of this state are owed better. And the good news is there will be an opportunity almost a year from now, on May the 22nd of 2018, for a real reset around this state. to really change things and to put people in the positions to set the agenda that aligns with the people in this room, not the people on the third floor under the gold dome.
Josh said it was a strange session. It was different. You know, we voted to lower the income tax, but to Josh's point or Senator McKoon's point, we need to look at overall tax policy. You know, we've got the House, the Senate, and the governor's office, and we need to do that. We're talking about Washington needs to do it. We need to do it here. You know, on that fantasy sports bill, I was adamantly against that, and I was pushing a destination resort casino bill. But I would tell you what it was going to do. It was going to create $2 billion of private investment. No, there was going to be no tax incentives, no tax abatements, no public funds. It was going to create 7,500 jobs, and it was going to give a 20% tax rate to the Hope Scholarship, where fantasy sports was going to not create one job, and the money was going to go offshore. It wasn't even going to stay in the United States. I said, I'm not going to vote for that. I don't even gamble. I wasn't doing gambling or the destination resorts. I was doing it more for economic development. A $2 billion investment, 7,500 jobs, and no public money, and it gets voted on by the people in referendum, and the money goes to Hope Scholarship. I was okay with that, creating jobs and funding our education. I'll continue to fight for the Hope Scholarship. I think the Hope Scholarship has been one of the best things we've ever done in this state. It's kept our best and brightest here. It's elevated our university status. I mean, we get calls every day about, can you help my son get in Georgia or Georgia Tech? It's hard to get in Georgia or Georgia Tech now than it was 30 years ago. I couldn't get in. And then it's also allowed kids to go to school that couldn't afford to go to school. So I'll fight for the Hope Scholarship all day long. And there's other states that have tried to emulate what the Hope does to no avail. So, but it was a different session, and it's going to be interesting what happens next year, because everybody's going to be running for a different office. So I don't think we'll get much done next year either. So, anyway, thank you.
I think they managed to get plenty done under the Gold Dome this year. I don't know that much of it is what the people in this room would be happy with, but certainly do nothing is not the right way to characterize it. Perhaps relative to some other legislative sessions where, you know, many more thousands of pieces of legislation were considered or passed, but there was quite a bit of serious legislation, and I would agree with the assessment that not much of it could really earn the title of Republican, at least according to how we've been talking about it here as a limited government, constitutional, conservative Republican. The bill that I'm thinking of was HB 434, which was introduced by the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, Wendell Willard, who also, his day job is being the city attorney for Sandy Springs. Actually, he has a private firm, and Sandy Springs is just, it's one of its biggest clients. So this bill would expand the power of eminent domain in, expand the power of eminent domain in Georgia to allow for property that has been seized by eminent domain to be transferred to private development interests. There's previously been a restriction on eminent domain only being for public use. You know, if the government's going to seize your property, it had better be for an interstate or a bridge, and not just because somebody wants to build a shopping center down the street from you. But in fact, this bill changed all that, and it also changed the previous rule was that if property was seized for eminent domain, the new purpose had to be in place for at least 20 years. That was now taken down to 5. So basically, you have the city attorney of Sandy Springs, in his role as House Judiciary Chairman, putting forward a bill that got very little fanfare. I happened to hear about it after it was already through the Senate committee process. And I will say the Senate Judiciary Committee did have a discussion on it, but the JQC really did take up a lot of the oxygen in the room. So we don't have to give Senator McKoon too much of a hard time for voting for it in committee, but he did. So this eminent domain expansion, I think, is really typical of what we saw from Republican legislators. It was an expansion of government power, and, you know, we have a Republican supermajority. Why are we seeing this? You know, whenever we have these individual conversations with legislators, they all seem to get it. They're all talking about the right things, and yet somehow as a body, we're not able to get what should be something that's pretty basic. The government should not be able to seize your property and transfer it to private interests, but somehow that's what came out of our Republican legislature.
Well, I was trying to decide how I was going to take the question because there's a couple of angles there. But since Catherine gave me such a great segue, I'm going to attack it like this. Ladies and gentlemen, our governor, our General Assembly, you know, our judges, when they take that oath of office, they invoke the wrath of God against them if they act unfaithfully to the oath. And the oath is not to the Republican Party. The oath is not to conservatism. The oath is to the Constitution. What disturbs me is, well, quite frankly, not that our state legislature was able to get away with what Catherine is speaking about, but do we understand that that is an erosion of some of our fundamental rights that our government is supposed to protect? And the fact that it got no news. You didn't see CNN. Oh, goodness gracious. You didn't see them holding mics in front of folks saying, well, wait a minute, doesn't the Constitution say? You know, the trap is that, you know, we tend to start thinking that we're supposed to be essentially holding our elected officials to the standard of whatever our political party, and I'll include the Constitution Party in that, what the party says as opposed to what they took an oath to. You know, hey. You know, 40 years ago, and definitely 50 years ago, if you asked Republicans, and quite frankly, a good chunk of Democrats, that, you know, is the right to life inviolable? Of course. So we don't have infanticide, we don't have euthanasia, we don't have elective abortion. Of course, Ricardo, what's the problem with this? But can we get a supermajority of even though the Republican Party has a supermajority in the state General Assembly and holds themselves out, generally speaking, as pro-life, can we get any substantive legislation that protects the Declaration of Independence is their primary responsibility to protect and defend innocent human life? Can we get that? Okay? So here's the alternative. You know, we need to start framing, and one of the things I so love about this forum is that we're not just talking about following a crowd here. We're starting to even look amongst one another and reminding ourselves of the standard which we say we're supposed to uphold. You know, as a public defender, you took an oath, didn't you?
Not to become a public defender, but to become a lawyer.
Yes. And that's what I'm getting at. You know? And if I can ask a quick question, at the end of that oath, what did you say?
That I swear to uphold the Constitution. Help me God.
Oh, wait a minute. Ladies and gentlemen, in my opinion, when we grasp and we hold the gravity of that to our elected officials, change will come.
All right, the next question is
going to
start with...
Oh,
sorry,
I'm off track already.
Straighten you.
Thank you.
Matt, you're on.
I would agree that it wasn't very Republican at all. This first time, as an elected official, of course, I was an aide before, like I said, but, you know, it's ironic, as Ricardo said, that, you know, we have a supermajority, we control the House, the Senate, the leadership, yet we continue to... You know, pass a record budget every single year. It is while we raise taxes on hunting and fishing license, and we exempt the rich on yacht repairs. Wow. It's unbelievable. You know, made me think of a story where you're talking about the internet sales tax. I know I asked the chairman. You know, this is a tax increase. It's a $274 million tax increase potentially. He said, "Oh no, it's not a tax increase. We just don't have a means of getting the money." And
like fees and taxes and things like that. So that was kind of, you know, I was learning down there, and it was like I was in a twilight zone. But it is very upsetting to see that on the last day of Sunny Day, I read an article by Tom Crawford that says we doled out some $600 million in subsidies and tax exemptions and whatnot on Sunny Day. The last hours there. You know, and subsidies, I'm very against subsidies. That's why I voted against the budget. I was the only sole vote, no vote in the House for that. It's corporate welfare. It's not the proper role of government. Not to mention the bonds. No one really talks about the bonds. We are a balanced budget state. Everybody likes to say that. But we added about $1.16 billion to the bonds with a total of about $16 billion. You know, that's roughly about $1,450, $1,500 per person in debt we have in Georgia, not to mention the unfunded liabilities. So it's definitely, and it makes me think of a quote by Madison, that, you know, the greatest threat to a Republican form of government is public debt. And I'll continue to fight against those types of bills. You know, we have to go back to what everybody's echoing here, going back to the founders, what they intended for our country to be. You know, as Republicans, we should be fiscally responsible. We should be for limited government. We should be for individual liberty. And we see that not panning out too well for us right now with the Republican control, everything. So I'd have to echo again that we need to elect people that are limited government, conservative Republicans that have principles. That stick to those principles no matter what the cost, no matter about worrying about getting reelected. Because I certainly know that I certainly made some enemies, and that because the way I voted. And that's made me think of the process. No one respects the process that I've seen. When I say the process, I mean the bill process. If I want to introduce a bill, it should be heard and based on its merit and not who the person is. I had people come up to me when I voted and say, you know, I'm not going to sign on to any of your bills. I'm not doing anything. I said, why is that? Well, because you voted against my bill. Well, your bill is a tax increase. Now I don't support tax increases. So it's surreal sometimes. So we have an opportunity to change this, and I'm glad to see people here who are involved, and we have a whole year till the election and the primary, and hopefully more people will get involved on the grassroots level, because it only takes the small minority to make a big difference. Thank you.
All right, thank you, panelists. The next question, and this one will start with Senator McKoon. Few citizens outside of Atlanta have the ability to directly participate and observe the behind-the-scenes legislative process. What can be done to bring the behind-the-scenes parts of the legislative process in full view of the currently uninformed public?
Well, I think that there are a couple of things. First of all, and Jack has mentioned this a couple times this evening, the state Senate is the only part of the legislature where if you want to participate in a committee meeting, you have to drive to downtown Atlanta from wherever you are. You have to arrive at the committee meeting in sufficient time to find a seat. And that's the only way you're going to find out what's happening in the committee, because no video record is made. And so Kevin referenced earlier the kind of the freedom that comes with knowing you're not seeking re-election. I was told by a number of people, well, it's too expensive to video record these meetings. So I took this very high-tech, very expensive piece of equipment, and I began to live stream the meetings. And I want to say I appreciate Senator Beach has been very supportive of the efforts that I have been making to increase our transparency. At the end of the legislative session, we added to the budget a line item to make sure that all the committee rooms that where state Senate committee meetings are taking place will be wired next year, and you'll be able to see those meetings. So that is going to be a benefit. People will be able to watch committee meetings next year in both the House and the Senate. I do think there's a lot more we ought to do. It's the 21st century. We need to meet people where they are. we should look at ways to leverage technology so that if you want to testify to a committee, that you don't have to come to downtown Atlanta to do that. Whether it's a YouTube channel that you could upload video testimony to, whether it's some other way for us to offer you the ability to participate in a virtual way with your state legislature and the committee process specifically, we ought to be about the business of doing that. We ought to look for ways, we do this with study committees where we travel around the state. There's no reason that we couldn't do something similar with standing committees. But we need to reduce the barriers to people participating. If we can do all these wonderful things with telemedicine I've learned about as a legislator and all these other things where a doctor can be 5 hours away and help somebody with a medical problem, surely we can encourage involvement in the legislative process among our citizenry. And the last thing I would say, and it kind of references the question we skipped over, is we need to utilize the entire 40 days of our legislative process. The fact is, when we compact everything down to the final day or two of the legislative session, it's impossible to have meaningful input from the people I represent. When we voted on House Bill 170, the transportation bill, the conference committee report was placed on my desk at about 9:30 in the evening. We voted for it at about 11:45. Edward Calloway, who's the CEO of Calloway Gardens in my district, they are a hospitality and tourism-based business. He did not have time to even call me or know what we were doing in the middle of the night that was going to affect his business, because every person using a room night at his hotel suddenly has got a $5 charge, and he's competing with Alabama, where they don't have that. Now, we can talk about the pros and cons of the policy. My point is, if we're going to have the ability for you to engage with your legislature, you got to have time to know what it is we're acting on, whether you think that particular policy is good or bad. So that's what we need. We need more transparency of our proceedings. We need more ways for you to engage without having to drive to downtown Atlanta. And we need to slow down our process in such a way that there is time for the public to read what we are doing, digest it, and respond. Thank you.
It's hard to follow Senator McKoon when he hits on all the points, but I would like y'all to give him another round of applause, because that line item in the budget would not have happened until he started videotaping every committee meeting. And I said, don't get my ugly mug in there. Because I sit next to Senator McKoon at a lot of our committee meetings. But he brought it to the forefront, and we will have everything. Listen, we're in the 21st century. There's no reason we shouldn't be transparent, and we shouldn't be able to do some of the things he talked about to keep you from coming to Atlanta. Especially, we take it for granted because we can get to the Capitol and pretty quickly from Metro Atlanta. But if you're living in Savannah and so on, it's tough to make a day to come to the Capitol. But a lot of people do it. But if we could make it easier through, like he said, the telemedicine type technology, it's out there. I mean, we have, we talk to people in London now, our business community, through these video conferences. We can do it. So we just need to be open and transparent. That's the best policy. Thank you.
I think all of those suggestions that the senators just mentioned are excellent ones, and it's wonderful to know that we will be seeing the Senate committee meetings online. That has been very helpful to see House committees online. And I was going to actually say, I think this is one area where there is already a fair amount of transparency if you put in the work. And, that's always going to be the issue. There's never going to be so much that the government can do that it will just be so easy for us to know everything that it's up to. There's always going to be some amount of work that we're going to have to do. And, legis.ga.gov does have all of the bills. It has all of the different versions. It has who's sponsoring them and all that information. So I think we do have a fair amount of transparency. So this is actually work that, those of us in the room are going to have to do to ensure transparency. And, we're going to have to hold our individual state reps and state senators accountable. I personally think we should be talking to them. We should be having town halls prior to session and after session so we can say, hey,
What are you going to be introducing this year? What's on the agenda? We shouldn't be surprised by these things. We certainly shouldn't accept it when our elected officials tell us they're surprised by these things. So we should know what's coming down the pike in a legislative session on an individual representative level, and then we should be able to get a summary from our elected officials at the end. But again, that's up to us as the voters. That's not something that we're going to be able to legislate. You know, people talk about term limits. That's our job at the ballot box to set the term limits that we think are appropriate. So I think this is one of those issues where I'll say the folks up at the Gold Dome are already doing a fair amount, and at this point we've got to keep up, and we've got to tell them that, you know, why are Republicans passing thousands of bills? Does Georgia really need that many new laws? I personally think that, you know, as a public defender, I have clients who are sometimes illiterate. These people are legally expected to know every aspect of Georgia law. They are legally required and held responsible for every aspect of Georgia law. To me, that is the same standard that we should be applying to the people who are writing that law. Our law has become so big that it is unknowable. So at this point, I think that one thing that the legislature could do to increase transparency is just not consider so many bills. Is Georgia really that bad of a place that we have to add this many new laws? I don't think so.
Well, Senator McKoon pretty much hit, especially as a information systems analyst, a lot of the points I wanted to say. Especially in the healthcare area with telemedicine. But Catherine, again, I'm always behind you. You steal my thunder all the time. Let's just be real. Ultimately, it is the responsibility of the citizens who elect their representatives in all three branches of government to keep them accountable. You know, it's only so much that they could do. How many people? Just think about your family, your immediate circle of friends. How many of them that you know actually know about any of the issues we've discussed this far? Okay, again, you know, we go to the mirror and we see the problem. Until we can help our neighbors see that it is in their vested interest to know what's happening and to understand what's happening and to keep their elected officials accountable, things won't change.
I'm mostly going to echo what everybody said. You know, it's voter apathy. It's people not getting out and getting involved. You know, I'm glad it's people here. That's awesome. We have a huge group here. We need more people. This is a war. It's an ideological war. You know, we have many things you can get involved in. GOP convention, state, district, county. You can do all these things to your local GOP. You know, hold your elected officials to the fire, to the feet to the fire. You know, we can't legislate morality. We try to, and it fails. You know, every vote that I cast, I explain. Every vote that I've ever taken, and this is going back to the first session, but I'll continue to do this, is explained on my website. Every vote is a yes or a no. I do hold town hall before and after session. And I do a weekly column every week during session, and a monthly column out of session. So I think that that's one way you could hold your elected officials to do, to get them more involved. But open and being transparent, that's a must, definitely. And just, you know, 15% of voters is the national average. You know, my district's pretty good. We had the third most conservative district in the United States. About 35% came out and voted.
Wow.
That's awesome, but it's only 35%. We can definitely do more, and we can always strive to do better, I think. And that is people getting involved. You've got to get involved.
This issue is real near and dear to my heart, I have to tell you. The transparency issue. When SR24 happened, we had two people sitting in the front of the room recording the videos. Okay? 2 weeks later, we went to another hearing. And I sat in there, and I almost got arrested. They had 11 cops come in the room, and all of a sudden they made the rules up after we already got there. Because anybody know what this is? I know Nydia does. The Red Book? This is the Sunshine Laws about film and recording. Anybody remember the show Get Smart?
Oh, yeah.
Remember the Cone of Silence? The Gold Dome was the Cone of Silence. They are exempt from freedom of information requests, and all the recording laws don't apply to us down there. They are exempt from everything. So we want open and transparent government. We couldn't even get them to get a legislation passed or the resolution for unrecorded voice votes on the floor only, for floor amendments only. When the vote came up, now here, you're going to love this. It was an unrecorded vote in the room, and it came out to be a no against it. I went back 2 weeks later and asked for the records, because it says in the Senate meetings they're supposed to record all minutes. Everything has to be recorded. I asked for the minutes. They said, well, Secretary of the Senate said it, they have to do it. There is no minutes. So we don't know who voted for what, and we don't. And they're exempt from it. And what are you going to do? You can't sue them. You can't do anything. So right now, we're just a little people down here. And until this stuff changes and that gets broken down here, if they're citizen legislators, then they need to get treated the same way we do if we do stuff. So that's some of the stuff that has to change down there. This has happened. This has been happening for a long time down there. But guess what? Pull the veil back and look what's going on. Start asking questions. Start questioning them and see what kind of responses you get.
I'll ask one more question, then we'll take a 5-minute bathroom break. And we've got more food back there, so don't hesitate. You don't feel like you're glued to your seats, you can go get more food, more drink, and come back here. Same thing for the panelists. Don't feel like you're glued to the seats. We'll drive on. So do I need to take a break now, or should I ask another question before we take a short break?
Let's do the break.
All right, here we go. All right, number five. Are you content with the current power relationship between the Georgia legislature and executive branch to include the governor and lieutenant governor's office? What would you propose to amend it? And then there's a follow-on to this. Answer that first. And then I'm going to follow up by asking the same question relative to the Senate and House leadership. So we'll start with the panel. Let's talk about relationship between the legislative branch and the executive branch to include the governor and lieutenant governor. Senator Beach?
Well, let me tell you what. When you look at our governor, when they rate governors, he's the fifth most powerful governor in the United States. Our governor has a lot of power. He appoints a lot of people, and I'll give you an example. I was appointed by Governor Sonny Perdue to the Greta Board, and I will tell you, I voted how he wanted me to vote, because if I wasn't, he'd ask me to leave the board. Then I got elected by the legislature to represent the 6th Congressional District on the DOT board, and I had freedom. And I actually made a motion to fire the DOT commissioner that the Governor Perdue did not want fired, Gene Evans. And I had the freedom to do that because I reported to the legislature, okay? And I will tell you that, one of the things Senator McKoon and I've talked about, I'd like to see the Board of Regents elected by the legislature. They're all appointed by the governor, and if they want to raise tuition, they get to raise it, and we have no say in it. And it's crazy. And so I would look at doing the same thing the way we elect a GDOT board to be elected by us. Now, again, going back to Governor Perdue, and this was before Senator McKoon's time and my time, he passed a bill called Senate Bill 200, and it allowed a planning director to report to the governor. The reason the legislature years ago did not allow the governor to appoint the DOT board members, we're only one of two states that do that. All the rest of the states, their DOT boards are appointed by the governor. The reason was the governor was saying where he wanted roads built, and the legislature said, wait a second, this isn't fair. So we took that power away from him, and we elected the GDOT board members. This is before I was even born. But with Senate Bill 200 now, he has the project. Jay Roberts, the director of planning and projects, he's picking the roads now again, with GDOT having to approve it, and they can disapprove some, but it got the governor's nose back under the tent at GDOT, and that was way before our time. But we can't allow the governor to continue to have that power over the legislature. Now, what we do have power over is the budget. We can vote against the budget, but I think that we need to look at different things, because once the governor gets that power, he's not going to give it up. I can tell you, even the next governor, if you went to him and said, we want to get rid of the planning director and go back to the way it was and let the DOT board pick all the projects and the representatives and the senators, it'd be hard to take that back. Wouldn't you agree with me, Senator McKoon? Once you give that power to the governor, it's hard to get it back unless you do it through a constitutional amendment, because he would veto it if it came to his desk in a regular bill. So I would just say that, you know, we need to look at that. And I am going to work with Senator McKoon next session on the Board of Regents. He wants it to go to vote to the public. I think a compromise may be to look at what we were talking about, but we're going to continue to discuss that. But that's my answer to that. Thank you.
I am not content with the current balance of power between the legislative and the executive branches in Georgia. I think that, you know, we had Casey Cagle come down to the Federalist Society, and the lieutenant governor was telling us all about his legislative agenda and the legislative agenda that the governor would be pushing and, you know, what they agreed on. And, it was a fine speech, but the whole time I'm just thinking, you're not a legislator. You're not a legislator, so why should you have a legislative agenda? And so again, this is an issue that it comes down to the voters. You know, we have to elect people to the executive branch who have a concept of checks and balances. You know, our entire constitution, both at the federal level and the Georgia level, relies on the idea that the legislative, executive, and judicial branches are completely separate. And unfortunately, there has just been so much overlapping. You know, everything that Senator Beach talked about, you know, that appointment process, but also there's a huge revolving door between the legislature and the judiciary. You know, Georgia has elected judges. Superior Court judges, appellate court judges, even Supreme Court justices are all elected, but we never see any contested elections because 95% of these seats are filled by the governor's appointment. There's sort of an unofficial agreement among all the judges in the state that they step down sometime in between, you know, elections so that the governor can appoint their replacement. In fact, just when in Cobb Superior Court recently, four of the judges just decided to serve out their terms, and that was kind of a scandal. Like, what are you guys doing? Just serving out your term and not running again? Because that had just become so unusual. So we really have a system where, this goes back to the part-time legislature, you have a lot of people who are dependent on politics for their livelihood, and they transfer themselves between the executive, legislative, and judicial branches as the opportunities become available. They might start out as an aide in one branch, like our current attorney general, who began his career, you know, with Senator Isaacson, and actually did not practice law for the 10 years before he became attorney general. We were just talking about this at dinner. And now he is the top prosecutor in Georgia, responsible for taking care of, you know, all criminal and civil cases for the state of Georgia. Someone who has never tried a case and simply doesn't have the experience to be able to handle that job. But he does have the political connections. And so I don't think we have a healthy balance of power right now. I think we have sort of we are approaching a unitary executive under the power of Governor Deal, who I would just note started his career as a prosecutor, as the district attorney in Hall County. So, and his son is a Superior Court judge in Hall County. So these connections, you know, we could spend all night talking about these connections and the fact that people who leave the legislature then end up getting appointed to a judgeship, or the other way around, like Johnny Caldwell, who was removed from his position as a Superior Court judge and is now sitting in the legislature, introducing bills to change the JQC that removed him from office in the first place. So again, it comes down to the voters. We have got to make a change and insist on the actual constitutional checks and balances that we all learned about in civics class.
I just love how she sets me up. Boy, she just puts them out there like, here it comes! The answer is no. I know I'm not content with the way things are. And as was noted, there are serious problems with the way things are being run. Now here's a question. Are peculations involved?
Yes.
Okay. Here's the thing. Ladies and gentlemen,
with all due respect to the honorable representative on the other end of the table, not only in the exercise of their responsibilities are they expected to uphold the highest standard of morality, but all legislation, and for that matter, all executive decisions with regard to regulations are indeed based on a standard of morality. The question comes down to whose morality? Because guess what? If you throw truth out the door, if you, you know, you say, well, you know, that whole thing about stealing, well, you know, I work hard. I ought to be able to get something for it. Well, if you're dealing with that mindset, if you're dealing with that kind of mindset, then what most of us in here would agree that, yeah, peculations are wrong. If you look at the environment we have today, do they think so? Well then, our responsibility is to replace them with people who do. And hold them accountable to a system of government and governance that requires them to be representatives of the common weal for the common good of the citizens of Georgia. And until we demand that, until we see that that really is the heart of the problem, there will continue to be the deals and the working because we aren't really paying attention.
Completely agree with Ricardo. We as public officials are supposed to be held to a higher moral and ethical standard. But there really is a big problem in the legislature. I know Josh McKoon knows this firsthand, of intimidation and bully tactics that is used by the executive, is used by the legislative. I've experienced it firsthand. The checks and balances system is not working right now. If you, as Josh put it, if you exercise, you have the temerity to exercise your legislative judgment, then you will be punished. Your secretaries will be taken, your chairmanship will be stripped from you. You won't get a bill passed. Both my bills, I couldn't even get a hearing on one of them because I voted against the budget. I got one hearing on another one, and these are Republican bills. This was, Josh touched on it before, this was a repeal of the $5 hotel tax in Georgia. This was a tax cut bill, would have cut taxes about $168 million, but I can't even get a hearing on it. A constitutional carry, I introduced this bill. This is actually on the Republican website. It says that Georgia Republicans support constitutional carry, but I can't get a vote in committee. So definitely there's a huge disconnect here with what's happening at the Capitol. And, you know, the control mechanisms, it's very upsetting, but it's an oligarchy, like Jack said. It really is. There's only a few people that really control these things. And like I said, voters need to come out. They need to make a difference here, and we can elect good people that are based on principles. And I think that's the way we can make a difference. Thank you.
This is great. You know, it goes all the way back down, really, to legislative council, because that's where so much of this stuff stems from. So I'm gonna step on some toes here. But I want to tell you, a few years ago, we had legislation regarding nullification of federal laws. It sent to legislative council, and I actually have a letter here, so anybody wants to see it, I don't make this stuff up. You couldn't make this stuff up. What legislative council said back to us is that if we tried to do this with nullification of federal laws, they said it was tantamount to an official declaration of secession from the United States of America and falls into the federal crime of seditious conspiracy as outlined in Title 18, Section 2384. I have a letter. So this is the kind of mentality we have. We have, what, 13 leg council, isn't it? Something like that, like 13 of them. And these guys down here are instructed what to do and what goes where. things get shut down all the time, and our legislators, and like I say, some of them are smart enough to say, well, that's not right. This is what our constituents have asked us to do. It is constitutional. You're not going to tell me it's not, because they feel that the federal government still runs Georgia, and Georgia is down here. It's the other way around. Georgia runs the feds. That's the way the Constitution's set up, and everybody seems to have forgotten that. Until we get that back in our legislators' heads, we are going to be subservient to the federal government, all the legislation, nothing's going to change, because they're all serfs at that point. All the legislators become serfs, and they do what they're told to do, and guess, again, who gets hold in the bag? Us.
Well, brother, when we stop balancing the budget with federal money, things will change.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the answer to the question is no. I agree with Senator Beach regarding the Board of Regents. We spend billions of taxpayer dollars on higher education in this state every single year, and the legislature has no voice, no ability to affect policy from tuition on down. That is absurd. People will say, well, you've taken the politics out of higher education. That's not true at all. What we have done is we've left the politics in, and we've removed any scintilla of accountability. The first question that you will be asked as a member of the legislature when you approach a member about signing a bill that you want to move through the legislative process is, where's the governor's office on this? And I understand. Because, as Senator Beach said, we have an extremely powerful governor's office. But I would submit to you that the legislative branch of government is supposed to be a separate and independent branch of government. So that question really should never enter into the analysis. We shouldn't be having conference committee meetings held on the second floor in the governor's office, as has occurred on multiple times during my tenure in the legislature. The governor's office should not be involved in the redistricting process. I can tell you from firsthand knowledge, the redistricting process I participated in 2011 was entirely decided by unelected people in the governor's office and the congressmen. You know, they decided what the districts were going to be, not the state legislators, who were constitutionally vested with the authority to draw the maps.
You're here.
So the legislature, unfortunately, has very little authority to be able to weigh in on important public policy matters. And, you know, you just have to ask yourself a question. Senator Beach illustrated it with his experience on the GDOT board. Where the legislature's making decisions, you've got a number of people involved, the power is diffused, but when you have the executive branch making decisions, it's one person. So which one is going to result in a more thoughtful and deliberative public policy process? So we are in desperate, dire need in this state of a reset in terms of the balance of authority between the executive and legislative branch. And this is not a popular position to take when we have a Republican governor. But I just want people to think. Again, we have an election coming around next year. There will be a Republican and there will be a Democrat. Do you really want Representative Stacey Abrams appointing the entire Board of Regents? Do you want Representative Stacey Abrams making over 2,000 appointments in state government? Do you want Representative Stacey Abrams deciding who your state court judges are going to be? To Catherine's excellent point. So the rebalance of authority, when we take the goggles off and say what really makes the most sense, the power ought to rest in the legislature. Much more authority ought to rest in the legislature. And the last point I'll make, it's a little off the question. Within the legislature itself, policies need to be in place to make sure that we don't get a similar dynamic within the legislature, where you have the Speaker of the House running the show for 179 other people. I think that's worthy of some point. And our Senate confirmation process for appointees needs to be a real confirmation process. We have one vote on roughly 1,000 appointees every year.
Wow.
We get some sheets put on our desk a day or two beforehand, and then there's one roll call vote to confirm all those people. I'm not for term limits for state senators and state representatives. I am for term limits for the Speaker of the House, the Lieutenant Governor, and Committee Chairman. If you want to take the power back and you want the power to be diffused, don't allow somebody to be the Rules Chairman for the entire tenure of their time in the legislature. Don't allow somebody to be Speaker of the House for decades at a time. If you really want to move things along and see our agenda move forward, the people in this room, then make sure that people know there's a sunset on how long they're going to be in charge of these very powerful positions. So if we rebalance the powers and then place term limits on those power positions in the legislature, we would have a much more productive public policy process for the people in this room.
I think we sufficiently hit both parts of that question right there. What we're going to do is we're going to go to the sixth question. Jim, we're going to limit to 2 minutes for each one of these, and then we will take a break and we'll gauge everybody's energy both on the panel on there. Is that acceptable to the group, to the body? All right, we'll do that. All right, the sixth question, and I think we'll start with you, Catherine, with this one. And this is one that was a backup question, but because we did, and he promised to respect this body, the Republican Party, out of respect to Ricardo Davis, I said, I want to make sure that this question gets asked to this group, because you, of all the panelists, have the most vested interest in this. Number six. The Georgia election process for district, state, and national elections is directed in part by law, in part by government administrators, and in part by party policy and process. Based upon your experience and observations, what, if anything, most needs to be fixed, improved, or left alone? Catherine?
You didn't want us to talk about the Constitution one? I have my
points. Yeah. We'll come back to that. I wanted to add a Ricardo for those reasons.
Well, I honestly, our ballot access laws are not good in Georgia, and I appreciate the efforts that Senator McKoon, as well as some others, have mentioned about, you know, bringing more of the jungle primary element in that states like Louisiana had, where basically if you want to be on the ballot, you can be on the ballot. There's just going to be a runoff between the top two vote getters. Right now, in order to run as anything other than a Republican or a Democrat, there is a very lengthy process of getting a number of signatures, many of which then get kicked out by the Secretary of State's office, and then you often have to litigate. So it really is hard to get on the ballot as anything other than a Republican or a Democrat in Georgia. And in fact, it was certainly a surprise to me when I ran for state rep. I thought I would be writing my qualifying fee check to the state of Georgia. Oh no, it was to the Georgia Republican Party. And so it is very interesting to look at the way within the Georgia code, the parties have actually been set up to control our political system. That said, ballot access is important, but it is hard to figure out where exactly you're going to draw the line. And to me, I think the other issues that we have talked about, I don't think ballot access, I don't think there's going to be a way to solve it that is going to be agreeable enough to everybody that makes it a realistic solution. So I know my friends in the Libertarian and Constitution Party, you know, do we pick new parties to give the same position as the Republicans and the Democrats to? That seems like just perpetuating a system that we already know have flaws. But in that case, you know, do we prioritize the Libertarian and Constitution parties, as we Republicans might want to do, over the Green Party and the Revolutionary Communist Party, both of which have significant presences within Georgia, very significant presences. So that's why, to me, ballot access, you know, we're not in a great status quo. But when we look at the changes that could be made to it, I'm not sure that many of the changes are a huge improvement. And there are so many other areas where, as my fellow panelists have pointed out, there are clear changes to transparency and accountability that would, in fact, help people have more access to the information about what their representatives are doing.
Man, you gave me a topic that I need 5 minutes on, but I will condense it. First of all, for those of y'all who are
kind of a little gray light. But you remember a little company called E.F. Hutton? What was their tagline?
Whatever they say.
Well, again, that they earn your trust with your capital for investment. And from my standpoint, even though Georgia is one of the most difficult states in the union to get ballot access, I count that as a welcome challenge. Now, you won't, probably won't hear some of my other colleagues say that. But here's the thing, the reality of it is that if we don't have the support of the voters, in other words, if they don't realize that there is the need for an additional political voice, and we don't make it clear to them, we don't make it obvious to them that there is a need, then if you gave us ballot access, things wouldn't change anyway. I look at one of our neighbor states, over in Florida. They have some, now they have some of the most easy ballot access laws in the U.S. But how many Constitution Party folks you have running there? Well, last cycle you had zero. So, again, I think that, to Catherine's point, yes, there are opportunities for change in the system as it stands right now. Now, with regard to making it a little more equitable, some of you all may have known that the Constitution Party of Georgia and the Green Party actually won a lawsuit against the Secretary of State in his official capacity with regard to ballot access for our presidential candidate, essentially bringing the ballot access requirement from roughly 60,000 signatures of registered voters to 7,500, an 85% decrease, okay? And at this point, the Secretary of State, you know, this has basically been a case that's been working its way through the court for 5 years, okay? And this time around, you know, the Secretary of State lost at the district level, lost at the appellate level, and is not willing to challenge it. So now the situation is, by judicial ruling, we have lower ballot access. So in 2020, we're going to work, and hopefully the environment will change so that people will say that, well, you know what? We need an outlet for what we believe.
Yeah, I think we have a big problem with ballot access. I mean, I think that we should have, I think since 1943, there's only been an R and a D in Georgia. So I would welcome competition. You know, I think that would be a great thing for us to have other candidates come out and see, have different diversity, and to see what, who all the players are, really. I would think we'd have a more, more representative government that way, absolutely. And this made me think. This question made me really think of, access and district redistricting and gerrymandering. And we talked about this a little bit tonight. And it's definitely a big problem. It's supposed to do it every 10 years, and it's behind closed doors. And it's something that we need to look into, and some ethical reforms for this as well. I know when I was an aide in the Capitol, one of the representatives was redistricted, and a straight line pretty much went right to his house, and he had to move so he could be able to run at the end of the seat. So there's a big problem there. And I hope that we can sort that out. I don't know the best solution to it, but it definitely shouldn't be controlled by a few that have a special interest into it as well. Thank you.
I would love to see ballot access. How about a little healthy competition? If you want to put a real Republican, if you really say you are a Republican, act like one, be one, show you are one, and then run as one. Otherwise, let's just see what happens, because this is going to chase a bunch of incumbents out, because a bunch of these guys, they shouldn't be there. All they're doing is occupying space, and that's what's been going on for a long time. 20, 30-year guys down there, like Josh talked about, the head of the committees. These guys have been the head of committees forever. These guys, he's the guy. This stuff has to change, and the only way it's going to change is if we change it. Ballot access would be great. I really believe that part of the problem is that the Republican Party has been the one blocking this because they have control of it. So healthy competition would be really, really good for Georgia. We're all adults, and if we have to choose from the lesser of two evils, what do we get? The same evil. So it's time for a change, but it'd be great to see it.
A historical note, at least when we were working for ballot access in the 90s, the Democrats actually let us have debate.
That'd be good.
So a couple of comments on this one. I'm kind of like Ricardo. I'd love to talk about this all evening. Ballot access. Third parties, if they field candidates for all the statewide offices, they should have ballot access. That was the rule before 1945 when we passed a law to basically keep the Communist Party off the ballot. So we ought to go back to that. If a third party can manage to field candidates for all statewide offices, they ought to be granted ballot access. Independents, we ought to make it very simple. If you go down there and file your paperwork and pay your qualifying fee, you ought to be able to get on the ballot. I was involved in my other job, my law job, bringing a lawsuit last fall on behalf of three gentlemen down in Stewart County, Georgia, who filed their petitions, who got hundreds or in one case over 1,000 signatures so that they could get on the ballot just to run for a county office. And the Board of Elections threw out signatures for reasons like the signature didn't match with the signature card. When the Board of Elections didn't have custody of the signature card anymore, they said, well, there's no signature to compare it to. Those were the sorts of reasons they were using to keep these folks from having the opportunity to serve their community. This goes back to an earlier question. If we want people to engage in our government, why, oh why, do we want to throw up all these artificial barriers to service? The other thing I would say is if you have third parties, what does that do in a general election? Suddenly, if there's a Constitution Party line on the ballot, the Republican nominee probably wants to be the Constitution Party nominee, or perhaps face a general election runoff. So it changes those dynamics in a way that more people get represented in the process. When it comes to our two major political parties, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party are barred from allowing state party delegates from nominating their candidates instead of a party primary. Now, whatever you think about that, I think that the parties ought to be able to decide that. Why does state government get to decide what a private organization does in terms of nominating their candidates?
Hear, hear.
Imagine how different it would be if you didn't have to sell your soul for millions of dollars to buy television advertising to have a prayer of being nominated to one of these statewide or federal offices. Just imagine the way that would equalize the playing field. If we went to Augusta or Macon or wherever we were going to meet, and 2,000 delegates who are really discerning and paying attention to the process and understanding where people are on the issues were deciding who those candidates were that were going to represent their party. The last thing I'll mention, I'll plug a little bill I've got, Senate Bill 20. Senate Bill 20 would insist, it would mandate, that if a local government wants to raise your taxes, that that election must take place in the November general election. Government wants to raise your taxes, that's fine. There are mechanisms for them to do that. But they shouldn't be able to pick their voters. They ought to have to go to the entire population in the election that guarantees the highest voter participation. I think it's a good policy, and I hope it's something we'll see done. Thank you.
You're here. I'll be real brief on this. We shouldn't put up any barriers for people that want to put their name on the ballot. It's just real simple. It's hard enough to find good people to run for office and go out and do the hard work and put yard signs out and go shake hands and walk door to door. We should not be putting barriers up for that, someone to be part of the political process. I will tell you on another note on elections, I got to tell you, I went walking door to door for Kay Kilpatrick this last weekend, and she got elected. I don't understand. And I guess, well, I know why, because of the overseas ballots for a federal election. But you've got Karen Handel's race. You had her running this last Tuesday, now Karen Handel's race on June 20th. I wish they could have ran together, because I think it would have helped Karen get more Republicans in Cobb County out. I will tell you, we better pay attention to this race, folks. This is a serious race. I represent both the 6th and the 11th congressional district, and when I was walking door to door, I was shocked at how many Ossoff signs were in this very Republican subdivision that I walk. And I'm telling you, I don't know what's going on out there with these folks, but he's got them fooled. And we better, even if you live in the 11th, if you know people in the 6th, here's what I'm worried about. I know my district pretty well in North Fulton. I represent Alpharetta, Milton, and Cherokee on the east side of 575. Alpharetta and Milton, they're in Sandestin and Destin on June 20th. They are, if we don't have early voting, we're in trouble.
That's right. Yeah.
Unless we're gonna have a voting poll down in Destin, Florida, which that's not gonna happen. I'm telling you, Georgia license plates are down on 38. Mm-hmm. And we better have a early voting strategy. I've talked to Karen about it, but we gotta wake up because this kid is spending money, and I tell you where he's beating us is on digital media. If you Google Atlanta Falcons or Atlanta Braves, he pops up. I don't know, that's way over my head.
YouTube.
How all that works.
It's all over YouTube.
And I'm telling you, we as Republicans sitting in this room, because here's what happens on this race, if he wins, it emboldens the Democrats for statewide races, every other race, all right? And if we let that happen, it's our own fault. I'm just gonna tell you. And it goes back to what Representative Gurtler said, it's apathy. I mean, I can't believe, you know, when we have every opportunity to vote early, absentee, there's no reason people should not vote. We give them every opportunity. Early voting, Saturday voting, absentee voting, and then the day of the election. And I will tell you, as a candidate and as an elected official, we work hard to get elected, and we have volunteers that work hard. And it really makes me mad when only 18% of people vote. I mean, it's heartbreaking. Even if you win, you want people to vote. So I didn't mean to get off on Karen's race, but I will tell you, we are very, very concerned about this race. So.
If I could say one word about the timing issue Senator Beach mentioned on the elections, almost every state in the Southeast that has runoff elections does not have this bizarre system we have where there's a 9-week runoff. So you may wonder, why is that? Why is Georgia alone in doing that? It's because we have not developed an acceptable alternative plan under the federal law so that we can unify our schedule. South Carolina, Louisiana, Arkansas, what they all do is they send ranked choice, some people call it instant runoff ballots, just to their overseas voters. It's less than 1% of the registered voters. And because they do that, they are able to set the schedule exactly how they like. The legislature could change that next year. We could go back to April qualifying, July primary, and a 3-week runoff later if we would make that change. So that is something that is within our power to do, but we have to make a legislative change in order to do it.
All right, we're Gumby, we can be flexible. Before I go into what may be potentially your last question, this is a question I did not provide to any of the panelists, but I think they're up to it. And the timing and the nature of this question is such that I think it's a good time for me to introduce somebody that joined us late because he came from, I know Richard, thank you very much for delivering Alex Johnson to us. All right, Alex Johnson, one of the candidates for Georgia GOP chair and also the co-sponsor of tonight's event, Alex Johnson.
Just wanted to say thank you all for putting this on. Thank you, Trenton, for helping co-sponsor this event. The GRA, I'm president of the Georgia Republican Assembly, which helped put this together. But thank you to all the panelists for being here and letting the voters and everyone know about the process and thoughts on the process, having an open and informed debate and discussion and on all of these issues. Because that's how we get more people involved. That's how we end the apathy. And as all of you know, I'm running for Georgia GOP chairman, and if you have any doubt who you're voting for, please talk to me before you leave. Thank you.
The reason why I said that I think this is appropriate is because this next question is one that has come up in every single Georgia GOP chairman debate, and I think there's been a record number of forums and debates that the Georgia GOP have faced in this election. It's my first, but it's a record. But it's come up in everything. So it's as we go to the state convention here in a little over a week, I think this is appropriate that we bring this up, and I'd like to hear the panel's thoughts on this. because this question has to do with what the Republican Party and its relationship with elected officials. What is the role of the Republican Party at county, district, and state in holding elected officials, to include Republicans, accountable? How should they exercise it? Carlos, I think this is you, and I know you can scratch out one and substitute it with any citizen of Georgia.
Well, first of all, I'll just say a little bit about the Constitution Party's process. When we have in our platform that we hold our candidates and elected officials accountable, you know, we have, and you know, most of our elected officials are local or municipal elected officials, but the same applies to them. They are contractually bound to uphold the platform that they are representing. And if, especially now at the national level, this has been enacted, if they violate that, then not only are they stripped of any, as it were, title or role in the party, essentially the party has the responsibility to call them out as being unfaithful, again, to what we call them to, and that is to uphold the Constitution and to act in a manner that is going to uphold the principal interest of the people and not their own. So if quite frankly, I know I'm amongst friends here, if there be anything, Alex, that I would charge you to do, is to do whatever you can within your power to enforce that, some teeth into accountability to those that you all help elect.
Absolutely. I was talking to Alex about this a few days ago. You know, definitely be there to be our voice to the Republican Party. We had the prior chairman come and speak to our General Assembly during session, and all I heard was that I need money and I'm not going to tell you what to do. There was no mention of principles. There's no mention of what the Republican Party stands for. Nothing. And I think that needs to change. And I was talking to Alex about this, and that's how it happens. I mean, you've got to call them out, and it will make a difference. I've seen during this session, some Republicans voted against, or voted for gun control, and they were called out. And you saw a pattern, their voting pattern change. And it changed, not very much, but it changed. Because they're getting feedback, and they're getting flack, basically, for not being Republicans. So definitely, I think that the Republican Party, we have state, district, and county conventions. That's an opportunity to talk to your elected officials if they show up. But the Republican Party needs to be, they're the voice for the principles of the party, and to promote that at all times. You've got to do that. And if elected officials aren't following those principles, and then that's why we have term limits. And that's why we can elect good principled people and get the bad ones out. Thank you.
Supposed to be principal.
Kevin asked me to.
Excuse me?
Limit, no.
Oh.
he asked me to limit each speaker to 90 seconds instead of 3 minutes or 2 minutes. So a minute and a half. And up till now, Jack, everybody has done that on their own.
I could say something, Jim, but I won't say it this crowd. Okay, so it's supposed to be principle before party, and this doesn't happen. What we have to do is have people, if you run as an R, you are an R. It's not just so you can get on, just like I said before, with the guy who ran against me in 39 years in New Jersey, which is a registered state. The guy was never registered as a Republican, ever. So we put people on all the time. We don't vet them. We don't qualify them. We do in Cherokee County. We're working on that pretty good, actually. And Harry knows. Harry's been through the process, and it's pretty good. But what we have to do is, if you're going to be an R, be an R. If you want to be a D or be an independent, just be that. But don't come in and under the guise of something else, and then we have to live with you when you get in, because you buffaloed everybody.
I learned a lot from Bo Calloway when I was chairman of my local Republican Party. One of the things he liked to quote all the time was George Washington, who said that it's up to us to raise a standard to which the wise and honorable may repair, and the rest we leave in the hands of God. I think that the purpose of the Republican Party is to raise a standard. It is to say, here are the things we believe. It is not simply machinery to elect someone. That's part of it, but it's not all of it. You know, in the UK, they're getting ready to have a general election. Every party publishes a manifesto. You know, the Republican Party did that in 1994. They called it the Contract with America. I don't know if anybody remembers that. But they said, here are 10 things we're going to do if we get elected. So I think the role of the Republican Party ought to be to set forward that standard and to say, here are the things that Republicans in the state of Georgia believe and are going to support and are going to fight for if they get elected. And then if you get elected and pretend like you're a Republican in order to get elected and then get into the legislature and do not vote in accordance with that, then yes, there ought to be some form of party discipline where the Republican Party lets people back home know, this person ran with our jersey on, but is voting with the other side. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think that, you know, the Republican Party is about less taxes, less regulation, and, you know, I will tell you, I say this all the time, that, you know, government doesn't create jobs. The private sector does, because I give a lot of speeches to Rotary clubs and so on. But what government can do is create a conducive environment with less taxes, less regulation, and an educated workforce for our technical colleges, our K-12 education, and our higher education to make sure we have these people trained for 21st century jobs. And I think that's what the Republican Party should be talking about. Jobs are a good thing. My son just got off my payroll. He graduated from college, and he is off my payroll. I like that. You know, and I will tell you one of the things that frustrates me with the Fulton County Republican Party, every time I get a call from them, they want me to sponsor a breakfast. They want me to write a check. And you know, I mean, I'm okay to do that, and I'll help out. But I can tell you, I don't know if you get that, Senator McKoon, but, you know, we're getting hit up for dollars all the time. And that's not, I mean, I'm supporting it, and I do write checks. But I think it's more than that. We got to make sure we're getting our message out. That's, you know, less regulation, lower taxes, and great education. So, anyway.
We got some
good
towels.
Okay, thank you.
We must look very hot up here.
Am I hot looking?
Gets to you.
So.
Anyway, that's. So I know we need to raise money, and I'm all about that to get good Republicans elected. And we got to, again, help Karen on June 20th.
I agree with what pretty much everyone has said about the purpose of the Republican Party to raise a standard. I think it's great. We've, you know, George Washington clearly has a good influence here. But we do have to raise a standard to which we can all repair. We do have to have a body where people can get involved and say, this is what I want the Republican Party to mean, and have that actually mean something, have some accountability, have some teeth. But I think also the Republican Party can help get people involved and allow them to interact with their elected officials. You know, all of the people in this room, you know, you're used to getting to talk to your state senator and your state representative, but that's not a common occurrence for most people in our communities and our neighbors. So I think the Republican Party really has a great position in offering tools to the voters to hold their elected officials accountable. Most people, it takes a long time to learn what the people in this room understand about how to get in touch with your elected officials. What are the ways to find out what's going on at the legislature and make a difference, actually have an impact? And the Republican Party has a pretty significant role in empowering those people, helping people go out and recruit in their precincts, and basically making sure that there are rooms all across Georgia, just like this, of committed constitutional conservatives who really want to restore, you know, everything that's great about our country, and they just need the tools to be able to do it. So the party has a big role in accountability, but it also has a role in just giving the voters the tools to get involved.
Uh,
by a show of hands, I got one question remaining. It was one of the primary questions before. If we have a 90-second response for this question, it was one that Catherine Bernard was very upset that it didn't come up last time because it was a primary question. Are we good for that, for a 90-second response to a final question?
Yes.
All right. Any objections? None heard? We will have the question. And Matt, I think with Representative Gurtler, we'll be back with you. Yeah, the Constitution. The Georgia Constitution is the second youngest in the nation, and is the 10th Constitution in our state's history. The current Constitution has been amended a number of times, with three such amendments were passed by voters last November. Some have suggested that it is time to start anew. Do you agree? Do you believe the legislature and governor always act in compliance with the Constitution as written? What are some of the key provisions or deletions to the Georgia Constitution you believe are most required? Representative Gurtler?
Thank you. Well, we all, well, you know, Josh and Brennan, we all swore an oath to the Constitution here, and we should take that seriously every single day. I don't see that a lot in the Capitol. What I've seen when I see the Constitution of Georgia, when I see the federal Constitution, because we swore an oath to both of those actually, the standard would be the federal Constitution. And I see that Georgia Constitution, sometimes it seems to pervert it in this a little bit. For instance, in Article 3, Section 6, and Paragraph 5C has to do with basically subsidies. And so we would basically exempt subsidies sometimes and not sometimes. And I found this out through research the Constitution, also with former Representative Bobby Franklin, who's now deceased. Another thing that I looked at was the Second Amendment. And the Second Amendment of the federal Constitution says, shall not be infringed. The Georgia Constitution, it says, shall not be infringed, but, and it goes, the General Assembly will make up these certain regulations and rules. So I didn't really like that very much. When I think of these things, I think of, you know, we touched on OSD, opportunity school districts, and also the T-SPLOST and HB 170. And there's a big disconnect to where the voters have clearly said that they don't want these programs, or they don't want these taxes. And then the General Assembly basically bypasses the will of the people to get their agenda accomplished. I think it was 9 out of 14 districts in the T-SPLOST said no. And then we had the largest tax increase in Georgia history pass in HB 170 with over $1 billion. Another thing that I noticed was one subject matter per bill, and this is in Section 5. And in my experience, what you see is a lot of the bills that come up, there's many different subjects into the bill, and some aren't germane. The biggest example, another in the Georgia Constitution, is when bills are rejected. And I don't know if people had followed the session, then you sure you know that there was a big controversy with how a Senate bill won in the House. On the very last day of sine die, this bill was brought up. It failed. And in the Constitution, in Article 3, Paragraph 3, we have an opportunity to reconsider it immediately. We only had a few hours till session ended. We can reconsider it. Then it failed immediately again. And now under the Constitution, in Section 5, Paragraph 8, we're not supposed to be able to reconsider this bill to the following session. However, a couple hours later, this bill was attached to an amendment to following another bill, and a couple sentences were changed, and so basically circumvented the will of this Constitution to be able to pass this bill. And it did pass, because I think around 25 legislators changed their votes, and that's how that happened. So definitely there's a big problem with this, and people not taking that oath seriously. Colleagues of mine stood up and called this out. And the author basically was said it wasn't the same bill, even though it was the same bill, and only a few sentences have been changed, and the bill was the same. So definitely paying attention to these things is a must. I'm down there, and I know that everybody has their lives and they're busy. But when these things get out, the Republican Party needs to call out this type of things happening, because the Constitution, many people died over this document. And this is founded on our country, and it's an expression of our natural rights that are God-given rights. And we've got to go back to that. It's the nation's backbone, and we're getting so far from it, And if you don't go back to that, then there's going to be a serious problem. And I think that we can go back to it, but we have good people like this standing up and having groups like this coming out and being involved in the grassroots. Like I said, it only takes a small minority, and an irate small minority, and you can make a difference, for sure.
I agree really with what Matt said, and the whole thing is how do you find somebody that has integrity and is going to do what they say they're going to do? Follow the Constitution. When Casey Cagle went past sine die 2 years in a row, nobody said anything. Everybody just went with it, and that's what it was. That's what a lot of these unrecorded votes were. These were things that they just pushed through, and nobody would stand up to do it because, again, it gets back to them being, you know, put back in a corner, and they can't do anything. I know one legislator, he told me he was threatened by two guys in his office and told him if he did not vote for this bill, he would never be on a committee, he would never be able to do anything. And if he didn't do it, so he voted for it, and I asked him why, and he said, well, I want to get something done. The guy sold his soul already. It was already done. And I'm not going to tell you who it is, but a lot of people in this room know this particular gentleman. And what has to happen is what the Constitution is very clear what it says. We should make these guys follow. And then again, it is our job as the party to call them out on. And it's not calling the guy out. We're not attacking the guy's character. They were elected to do a job. And when they don't do that job per what their contract is, which is the Constitution and the agreement they made with the people when they got picked, that's the problem. And that's what needs to be called out. We're not calling somebody a name. We're not getting anybody else. This is all fact.
So you're not naming names? I mean, you say,
let's hold it. I can name all sorts of names, David. I'm not going to do that right now because I don't think it's conducive to what we're trying to do right now. We're trying to get a point out. And right now the point is that it's up to all of us, not just a few of us, to get on these guys when they do something wrong and to tell them. And in a way, so they understand why did they do this? Just ask them the question. And if they don't want to answer, you got your answer. So, and it's time for us to do this. Like I said, I'll give you all sorts of names. If you want names, I got all sorts of names.
We definitely need to completely revise the state constitution. When the Democrats were in charge, they did this roughly once every 20 years. That's why the last time the constitution was changed was in 1983. Because it was on the agenda for the Barnes second term that never occurred. But we as Republicans ought to now take the historic opportunity that we have had over these many years now, where we've had a supermajority in the Senate, very close to a supermajority in the House, to make these changes. We need to weaken the governor's office substantially. Mm-hmm. We need to strengthen the legislature substantially in general terms. We need to put the right of free exercise on the same footing as our other fundamental constitutional rights when you're filing a claim against state or local government. I think the other part of the question is, when has the Constitution been violated, or when have you seen that occur? The best example I can give you is a bill that one of my Senate colleagues offered, and it had to do with trying to deal with some of the consequences of human trafficking. And the way she wanted to go about doing that was to place a tax on adult entertainment facilities. The Constitution is explicitly clear, revenue-raising measures must originate in the House. So I think I was one of two or three people that voted against it. I'm sure at some point people will say, oh, why are you pro-strip club or anti-human or pro-human trafficking? But the truth is, I looked at that bill, I looked at the constitutional provision, and I did not feel that I would be honoring my oath if I voted for a revenue-raising measure that originated in the Senate. The other thing that we ought to really look at, I don't know if it rises to the level of violation, I think it does. The Constitution gives explicit authority to the Senate to confirm the governor's appointees, and we made this point a little bit earlier tonight, but I think it bears repeating. The Senate confirmation process, I believe the Constitution demands more than a single roll call vote on a list that's put on our Senate desks. We ought to have committee hearings. There ought to be questions asked. How about just a simple, the same sort of background check somebody might get for an entry-level job offer? Could we at least do that? We actually confirmed someone to the Board of Corrections several years ago who was a well-known
open borders activist who was associated with radical far-left organizations. And none of us knew it because, again, we were given almost no notice. We had this list in front of us of about 1,000 names. And I can tell you this, and then I'll hush, but the governor's office doesn't seem to have the time to help us vet these people. But in my case, when I started voting against these confirmations as a matter of course to protest the process, they did have the time and taxpayer resources to send letters to every appointee in my Senate district to let them know I'd voted against them. So we need to revise that process if we're going to have Senate confirmation. So that would be my response. Thank you.
Yeah, 1983, the Democrats were in charge, so we need to look at rewriting the Constitution. We need to put a study committee together or some kind of task force together to look at that. Also, on those Senate confirmations, the one that we do confirm was Senate Bill 200. We were, because it was new, and we were adamant, and I was not in the Senate at the time, but the Senate was adamant that they had to confirm him, and Jay Roberts has to come before the Transportation Committee, and he has to go through a confirmation process. We should do that with all these appointments, because to Senator McKoon's point, we get something laid on our desk, you don't even know who they are. I mean, it's just we're just rubber stamping it. So I think that needs to be looked at, just like the U.S. Senate confirms.
Just like,
yes?
I have you address this question. With a 40-day session and 1,000 appointees, how are you going to get them?
So the way to address that would be for us to have, we have committee meetings that occur outside of the regular legislative session. Mm-hmm. So the committees could meet and handle this over the course of 8-9 months. And then, once the committees have had the opportunity to vet these people and then place them on a list, I think people would be a lot more comfortable with a roll call vote on multiple nominees if they've gone through a vetting process in committee. But we're not restricted to those 40 days in terms of committee action. That's just when the whole legislature meets and you have a question placed on the Senate floor or the House floor.
Thanks for clarifying.
Yes, sir.
Well, I guess I'm up. Were you finished?
I'm done. Yes, I'm done.
Well, I have to say I'm thrilled. I, you know, brought my Georgia Constitution with me, and some of our elected representatives have already cited to the very parts that I had marked. The single subject bill, that's one that just, you know, routinely gets violated. The revenue having to be revenue raising having to originate in the House, also routinely violated. And you know, these aren't issues where you can have a debate on it. They're just getting violated. Like, every bill is violating the Constitution. And I think that really raises the question of, you know, what does the Georgia Constitution mean? You know, when I took my oath to become a lawyer and got sworn in, I also took that oath to uphold the Georgia Constitution. I probably hadn't even read it at that time, all 80 pages. And the more I've read, the more I've realized how it's been larded up over the past decades with a lot of really, really problematic content. The first few pages are good. They go into the Bill of Rights, but you know, after that, it just, you know, goes off the rails into lottery funding, education funding, massive sections on debt that contain statements like the state will allow development authorities, you know, unlimited authority to exempt projects from taxation, and debt that they take on doesn't count as debt under the Georgia Constitution. So that's some real magical thinking right there, that the Constitution can declare debt by a government entity to not be debt. So really, you know, I think we're kind of on the horns of a dilemma here on you know, insisting to our elected officials that we want them to follow the Georgia Constitution. Because yes, the single subject bill and revenue origination and the Bill of Rights and all of that, we do want them to adhere to that. But I have to agree, we desperately need a revision and a reduction in the Georgia Constitution. A constitution is not supposed to be a replacement for a body of statutory law. It's supposed to be the principles guiding that statutory law. Mm-hmm. And at this point, we're very far from that. I would also urge folks to look out. One of your Cherokee legislators, I think with very good intentions, not this previous session, but the session before that, introduced or discussed a bill to require the legislature to follow the Constitution on certain issues of funding and subject matter, etc. This is just a terrible idea. If we're not following the Constitution as it's written, writing a law telling legislators to follow the Constitution is not going to make the situation better, and actually might make it worse.
That's
because
right.
Constitutional authority trumps statutory authority. So we really have to watch out for fixes like that that ultimately make the problem worse. And of course, we all need to be aware of problems like the JQC amendment, which has come up several times today. Not only was this rushed through with very little discussion, you know, a lot of public discussion conducted after the amendment was put on the ballot, when they recognized that people like Josh McKoon and Lester Tate were actually going to bring it to people's attention. You know, then we find out that the amendment wasn't even written correctly and actually leaves us with three different JQCs at different points in 2017. So I think we're really the lesson to take away from this process is that even a lot of the legislators feel like this process is out of their control. Even the Constitution that is supposed to be fundamentally guiding our actions is become out of our control. So yes, you know, let's look at revising it, but then, you know, are we in a convention of states situation where we're opening things up to a lot of interests that, you know, could expand government further? So I think this is really a big challenge for everyone in this room to take on, you know, as you talk to your elected representatives, you know, what do you want from the Constitution, and is the Georgia Constitution really the best guidestone for us right now?
She's like, if I was a performer, she'd be my hype man.
I mean, she's you up on that.
Yeah. Well, as to what we should do with our state constitution, I agree with Catherine. If we essentially take up the matter of the entire constitution whole cloth, I don't think that's necessarily prudent. Because again, especially if you read the first few pages of that Constitution, that stuff there that we really don't need to touch, because it again follows the spirit of the founders and the three delegates from Georgia when they represented the state in the ratification of our current Constitution. It is my opinion that the Commonwealth's Constitution should focus on establishing the framework to protect and defend every citizen's God-given rights. To that end, it should focus on justice for all persons in protecting their lives, their liberties, and their property. Secondarily, its scope should focus on those subjects that impact the common welfare of the entire state. And you could make an argument for state roads, for example. It should not focus on specific persons, classes of people, regions, or organizations. Nor should the framework enabling the, should, nor should it be, our Constitution, should be the enabling framework that provides public funding of welfare, personal or non-corporeal. And we mentioned a minute ago regarding the situation with tax exemptions, etc. Now, how many of y'all knew that before she brought that up? Okay, now see, again, as they say, the devil's in the details. You know, if we really understood some of the more egregious parts of our state constitution, and understood what we needed to do, I would recommend that we go in and essentially line by line begin to repeal parts of the Constitution where we can build up a strong case and have a consensus amongst the citizens of the state of Georgia that we need to roll this back.
I believe that we are better Republicans, and more importantly, we are better citizens as a result of our experience tonight. We can pat ourselves and applaud ourselves for showing up, and that would be well deserved. But the vehicle for our learning tonight was the six panelists that we have up here. So how about a round of applause for six panelists? you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. But wherever you go, take some of that extra food and dessert with you. Otherwise, somebody's got to haul it off and feed their dog. All right. Thank you all very much for being here. Appreciate it. I took my shoe off.